Well, welcome everyone to the Institute of World Politics. First, let me say I'm really sorry that we had to reschedule for this morning. Obviously, there's nothing we can do about the weather, but 9 o'clock on a Tuesday morning is not the ideal time for a lecture. Never was when I was in college. My name is Noah Rudolph. I'm the Executive Vice President here at the Institute of World Politics. I've been here for about 8 months, and one of the things that I've been consistently impressed with about the school is our ability to get incredible lecturers and to speak about timely topics. And today is certainly no exception. History is core here at the Institute to our curriculum. You'll see that if on your way out you grab a copy of the curriculum, you'll see that history has always been and will always be core to our curriculum here. We understand that it's often our best teacher, and we also understand that unfortunately sometimes it repeats itself. I think we're seeing that a little bit around the world today, which is why today's lecture is so timely and important for those reasons. And with that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Timothy White, professor of political science at Xavier University, visiting fellow at the Moore Institute at the National University of Ireland in Galway. Without further ado.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. White. I normally teach at 8:30.
On Tuesdays and Thursdays, so this is late for me, actually. So I appreciate you coming. I know the weather was a bad omen in terms of St. Patrick wouldn't have liked it, but we're here today, and I really appreciate Katie helping invite me and all of you coming today. I'm going to speak on 10 central lessons that come from a volume that I edited. I worked on the volume when I was a visiting fellow at NUI Galway at the Moore Institute in 2011. And by the time we processed the chapters, they were published formally in November with the University of Wisconsin Press. So a lot of the work here is in some ways not my own. I tried to bring together what I thought were the principal lessons that came from the process in Northern Ireland and bringing together many of the world's experts. So we have people from all over the North America, Canada, and the United States, as well as England and Ireland, who wrote chapters for me. So the first lesson that we focus on in the book, in some ways, is the most central, many would argue, and that is, and this is kind of long-winded, but various groups learned different lessons in Northern Ireland, and their positions and identities evolved through the process. And there's multiple groups we'll talk about, the groups within Northern Ireland themselves, Protestant and Catholics, and their political parties, as well as the British, Irish, and U.S. governments. Most importantly, their positions evolved, because if you think about the history of Northern Ireland from the 1970s onward during the Troubles, most people considered it, like other parts of the world, an intractable conflict. When I was an undergraduate in the 1970s, one of my professors, you know, said, Northern Ireland is one of those parts of the world that can't be solved. And in the end, while we can argue Northern Ireland isn't solved in some ways, it's a much more peaceful place than it was in the 70s and 80s. And how have we made progress in the way that we have was the purpose of trying to explore what we did. And roughly we're 15 years after the Good Friday or Belfast Agreement. We should be able to look back both at how that process worked to some extent, as well as what's happened since to help explain what levels of success we've had and why. So who are the different groups in Northern Ireland? The person who wrote the chapter focusing on this is a colleague of mine at Miami of Ohio, Will Hazelton. Will is born in Northern Ireland on the 12th of July, and if you're a Protestant born on the 12th of July, you're going to be named William, if you know Northern Irish history at all. So he gets his name from his birth date, which was the date that King William of Orange defeated the Catholics in the Battle of the Boyne. He grew up mostly in America, in Chicago, and then taught for years at Miami and recently retired from there, but still does some lecturing and work. He focused on how what he called we should focus on not trying to apply Northern Ireland as a cookie cutter model, but to understand the nuances and complexities of the lessons learned. And he said the lessons were best learned at home, meaning that we have to understand how each of these groups understand what they learned and how different each of them saw the lessons to be learned from the Northern Ireland peace process. He starts the chapter with a quote from this speech that President Clinton gave in Armagh in September 1998. And this was an important time in the peace process. The agreement had been ratified both in Northern Ireland and the Republic by this point, And it was soon after the famous bombing in Omaha, which seemed to portend maybe the unraveling of the peace process and the most violent act actually during the entire Northern Ireland conflict. 28 people died. So you can try to play. This is where you go up and go right there. See where it hit play, and you'll hear President Clinton's speech. Try it one more time, maybe. So what Hazelton does with this speech is argue that Clinton had it right, that what we should see Northern Ireland as sort of an example of how peace can work, but not something that should be tried to be simply copied or reproduced in other contexts. And if we look at what's happened since the Good Friday Agreement, many politicians in Northern Ireland, and even British and American politicians who made their fame in some ways in the Northern Ireland peace process, have tried to go off to other parts of the world and act like they can help. And in some cases, those are more ego trips than they are actual efforts at resolving conflicts in many parts of the world. So we need to focus on what exactly happened in Northern Ireland and what of it is instructive. Maybe not can't be exactly replicated, but is instructive to other peace processes. And we're going to start by looking at the different groups that were key to the peace process. The first group we'll talk about is the sort of moderate nationalists led by this man, John Hume. Hume was the leader of the Social Democratic and Labour Party, and from the era of the Troubles through the agreement, this was the largest of the Catholic parties of Northern Ireland. And Hume in some ways was, you could argue, the great visionary of the peace process. There's been a lot of work done in IR about how one of the fundamental tensions in the world since the creation of the state system is borders and border conflicts. And if you can get borders resolved, that dramatically reduces the likelihood of war and military conflict. And in some ways, Northern Ireland is a classic territorial dispute because many would argue Northern Ireland should be part of a united Ireland, and others would argue Northern Ireland should be part of the United Kingdom. And it's very hard to have two pieces of territory simultaneously be part of two different states. It's kind of practically impossible how we conceive of sovereignty. So given that, Hume re-envisioned the conflict from one focused on territory and who owns or controls or what is Northern Ireland a part of, but instead said politics is also about relationships. And he focused on three different relationships he thought they could be improved. And if we improve these three relationships, in a sense, and stop focusing on territory, a peace process could emerge. And ultimately, this was the basis of the Good Friday Agreement. There were the three strands of the agreement, they're called, are the three sets of relationships Hume talked about. They were the relations between Catholics and Protestants in Northern Ireland, the relationship between the northern and southern part of Ireland, and the relationship between Ireland as an island and Britain as an island. And if you focused on creating institutional arrangements that tried to improve the relationships in those three elements, you could get to a more peaceful place in Northern Ireland, okay? And he pushed and promoted this, and in the end, this became the fundamental architecture of the agreement. In order to achieve that, he had to do all kinds of things. He had to start trying to negotiate with his political rivals within the Catholic community, Sinn Féin. While he always stood against the use of violence, he started secretly meeting with Sinn Féin in the 1980s, trying to convince Adams and other Sinn Féin negotiators that it was in their interest to stop bombing and start negotiating a peace. And that was an important element of getting Sinn Féin to be part of the peace process. He also had to learn to negotiate more honestly and effectively with the British government over time, who gradually took him more seriously, with the Irish government, and even in some ways with the American government. The other key architect of the agreement from the Unionist side, who also won the Nobel Prize along with John Hume, was this man, David Trimble. Trimble is often seen as a key player. Obviously, he was leading the largest Unionist party in the negotiations. He was the only large Unionist party involved. The other significant Unionist party refused to negotiate the Good Friday Agreement once Sinn Féin was allowed in. The DUP withdrew from negotiations and opposed the agreement. Trimble came to power in 1995 after the party had gotten tired of James Molyneux, and they said, we need a young guy who will really be a vanguard defender of unionist interest in negotiating and with the British government. So Trimble came in known as a very hardliner. He had been vitriolically defending the right of the Orange Order to parade wherever they wanted to and offend whatever Catholics they wanted to. So he was no friend of moderation or anything else in his history. But he came to see the peace process, and I think this is important, as fundamentally satisfying the unionist desire to maintain Northern Ireland as part of the United Kingdom. That is the ultimate goal of unionists. Everything else to him should be negotiable, of other relationships, other institutional arrangements, as long as Northern Ireland remains part of the United Kingdom. And that was enshrined in the document. So for him, negotiating that, making concessions to nationalists, to the Irish government, was something that he was ready to accept because he saw it as necessary to get a peace. Now, this was politically troubling to many in his own party. They saw him making concessions to Catholics, weakening this party's position. In the end, as the agreement was signed, major leaders, his chief lieutenants, people within the highest levels of elected officials of the UUP abandoned him. Jeffrey Donaldson chiefly among them, and moved to the other more extreme Protestant party, the DUP. And Trimble was able to survive the initial process, and ultimately he ends up losing his seat in the Northern Ireland Assembly, his seat in the British House of Commons, his leadership of the Unionist, Ulster Unionist Party. You could argue by making the concessions he did. The British rewarded him. He now sits in the House of Lords, so he's happy enough, I think, with that position. But as a political elected official, as a politician, he sacrificed a lot. And there's been some wonderful biographies written about him that highlight his thinking, his attitude, his willingness to moderate and change on certain concessionary points that were key to allowing the peace process to move forward. Another key actor clearly was Sinn Féin and its leader, Gerry Adams. If you look at the evolution of this party, in some ways, it's the party that changed the most, you could argue. Because Adams starts out as a violent Republican. While he's never admitted he was part of the IRA, most people believe he was a commander, if not the supreme commander of the Irish Republican Army. He was clearly affiliated. Many of his friends were in the IRA, if he wasn't directly involved, as he claims. And as a Republican, he believed that the ultimate goal should be a 32-county republic. The Brits need to leave. Brits out. And he had even supported and developed a policy he called the Long War, in which he believed through a long terrorist struggle, he don't like to use the word terrorist, but we would call their guerrilla tactics, whatever you want to call them, terrorist strategies, that eventually he could bomb his way to get the British to leave. That policy of the Long War came to be questioned in the 1980s, partly being nudged by people like John Hume. They came to believe, Sinn Féin leadership, both Adams and McGuinness, his chief lieutenant, that the British weren't going to leave. While they could continue to cause mass suffering in London with bombings, in British cities with bombings, obviously Northern Ireland with bombings, that wasn't going to force the British army to leave. And in the early 1980s, they started running candidates for office and got some had some electoral success when Bobby Sands was first elected. And then other people started getting elected under the Sinn Féin label. So they went from what was called a pure ballots or bullet strategy to a ballots and bullet strategy. And ultimately, he supports a ceasefire in 1994, convinces the IRA to at least temporarily suspend all military operations, and opens up an avenue for peaceful negotiations. Now, that initial ceasefire didn't work, but he was able to get another one put in place by 96, so that in 97, so that by the time of the peace process in 98, the negotiations, George Mitchell lets him represent the Republican movement, in a sense, in the negotiations, and he agrees to the agreement, which says Northern Ireland status can only be changed by majority consent, not by any IRA bombing, okay? So the fundamental tactics and strategy that they had used historically have to be let go. It takes a long time to decommission the weapons, as called for in the agreement, but ultimately it works. And Adams and McGuinness ultimately become part of the new political process of Northern Ireland. So they clearly evolved through the peace process. Next. Another group was the British government. And we're going to focus mostly on Tony Blair. Obviously, Major had been significant in the early 90s as the British Prime Minister, but because he was requiring unionist votes to keep his prime ministership, he was very reluctant to do anything to alienate unionists. When Major wins his election in 1997, he has an overwhelming Labour Party majority. He doesn't need any Northern Ireland votes to keep his position as prime minister in Westminster. So, and he also has a vision of the reformation of the UK, called what he calls devolution, which allows for local assemblies to be created in Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland. So the peace process is something he's part of. He also had, a grandmother who was from Sligo. He was much more familiar with Northern Ireland. He appointed Mo Mollam, who was clearly the most effective representative of the UK ever in Northern Ireland. She understood the local context and was a very effective advocate of the British policy within the context of promoting peace. He became personally committed to it. And when he looks back, if you read his memoirs, I think it's called My Life, he's very proud of his achievements in Northern Ireland. And if you look today back on Blair's era, especially in terms of foreign policy, he has a huge blemish from the British perspective. His support of George Bush in the Iraq War is not popular, but his work in Northern Ireland was, and he was named after he left office in 2007 as the EU representative to the Palestinian-Israeli negotiations. He clearly thought he could do his magic in the Middle East as he had done in the north of Ireland, and it didn't work out. But anyway, that's Tony Blair. But he promoted peace in ways and pushed the peace process, and we'll talk about some of his lessons that he talks about more generally later on. But the British government moved and was willing to make changes and move the negotiations forward in a way unlike any previous British government. The next character was Bertie Ahern, and if you know much about Irish politics, he is now loathed by Irish people because of the financial crisis that came to Ireland under his leadership. But Bertie's one, perhaps, kind of like Blair's saving grace, was his role in the peace process. And their eras are almost coterminous. They both come to power in the late 90s, and they served for about 9 or 10 years together. So they became true partners in the peace process, not just negotiating the agreement, but through all the problems of implementation, ultimately achieving that so that by 2007 the institutional framework finally becomes solidified and we have a more stable institutional framework in Stormont where the Northern Irish Assembly operates. As a Republican, and this may be not so obvious, but Bertie came from a very Republican family where Ireland's constitution said that Northern Ireland was part of Ireland. It claimed it in the constitution written in 1937. Articles 2 and 3 assume that Ireland is a whole island and the government of Dublin assumes sovereignty over the whole thing. Now, practically speaking, Bertie never tried to assault British forces in Northern Ireland or anything of the sort. But there is, in the mind of a Republican, Ireland is a unique whole. It's all 32 counties. You sometimes see bumper stickers here, 26 plus 6 equals 1. That's the Republican mentality. It's one country. Even though he came from that tradition, he was willing ultimately to rescind Articles 2 and 3 of the Constitution of their own government, of their own state, what's called the irredentist claim to the North, because he saw it as key to a peace process, one which would bring peace, stability, and greater rights and interests for Catholics in Northern Ireland that the Republic of Ireland tended to have sympathy with. So Bertie Ahern plays a key role as well in the peace process. Now, beyond understanding who the different players were, part of the book tries to focus on understanding how identities change. And in chapter 3, Landon Hancock from Kent State uses social psychology theories to explain the logic of identities and how identities change. And he focuses primarily on how, in the midst of a conflict, certain key events can change the salience of your identities, the importance of certain elements of your identities, to make you re-identify with new things. So the major graph that highlights this, and he looks at both editorial information, survey evidence, as well as interviews of people. But looking at the survey evidence, there are two key peaks when there's an annual survey done in Northern Ireland called the Northern Ireland Life and Times Survey. And you see two peaks both right after 94 and 98 when people became much more positive in their expectation of future relations between Protestants and Catholics in Northern Ireland. These two peaks were the first ceasefire and the Good Friday Agreement. Okay? When these things happen, when there is an end to the existing conflict, it makes people recalculate not just who am I, but how I relate to my potential rival or enemy, the other community. So it allows people to rethink who they are. And in the next slide, it refers to chapter 4 that explores one example of this and how unionists have begun the process of re-identification. And one way they've done this, instead of seeing themselves as purely oppositional or reactionary, the great scholar of unionist Arthur Haughey calls this, you know, he self-proclaims that we suffer from a siege mentality. That historically, the unionists think they're surrounded by Catholics on the island, the British are going to abandon them, so they're permanently under siege. Okay? How can you go from this siege mentality where you see yourself under siege, oppositional, reactionary to Catholics, the British government, to some other form of identity? Well, these two scholars, both from John Carroll, Wendy Weidenhoff Murphy on the left and Mindy Peden on the right, used to teach in Northern Ireland through the university's program in the summer and came to be very interested in murals and how murals were being repainted in Northern Ireland to sort of signify the changing way that in Protestant neighborhoods, unionists were self-identifying. And they explored what Americans would call the Scots-Irish tradition, what in Northern Ireland is called the Ulster Scots diaspora. And they focus on what the Ulster Scots see as the three dispersals. The first dispersal is how did people who we call Ulster Scots get to Ulster, to the northeast quadrant of Ireland? They came from Scotland. That's why they're called Ulster Scots or Scots-Irish. And they came starting in 1609. And if you know how the British treated Ireland, you know that it became basically impossible for Catholics to own land in Ireland. At that point, Ireland looks like Oklahoma during the Sooner times, right? Native Americans couldn't own land, so the white settlers, wherever they came from, could own the land. In Northern Ireland, Protestants could own land. Now, who were the Protestants who came to Northern Ireland? They were distinct, in a sense, from some other Protestants that came to the south of Ireland. They were overwhelmingly from Scotland, and they were Presbyterians. Now, that may not make a big difference in America, the difference between a Presbyterian and some other what we think of as a Protestant sect. But you have to understand, under English rule, there was only one official church. It was the Church of England. In Ireland, it's called the Church of Ireland. That is the official church. If you're in that church, that means you're not only loyal in a religious sense, but you're also loyal to the king in a political sense. Presbyterians were not Church of Ireland. They were seen by the Anglicans as an inferior religion, disloyal to the king in a religious context, as the church, the king was the head of the church. And the Presbyterians, therefore, even though they come to Ireland, we might think of them as being better off than Catholics. The great historian Kirby Miller has tried to argue we're better off seeing Presbyterians and Catholics in similar ways as both under the gun of the Protestant establishment, the Church of Ireland, and those who had rights, because they could own land. They had economic rights and privileges that Presbyterians didn't have. Presbyterians were better off, to be honest. They had more rights than Catholics, but they couldn't do things like even, I think, Protestant ministers or Presbyterian ministers couldn't even officiate marriages, for example. They weren't legal marriages. So there were clear discrimination that they faced when they came to Ireland. Then there were famous events like the siege of Derry in 1689 and earlier a massacre of Irish Protestants that occurred throughout the country in 1641. And all this helped create the siege mentality. So the people come from Scotland, they come to Northern Ireland, they're not treated well by the official government even when they're there. They feel under siege from this large Catholic population that pre-existed them, in a sense, the old Celtic peoples who were Catholic from the time of Patrick onward. So that's sort of the first dispersal. The next couple slides highlight the banners that you'll see throughout Northern Ireland highlighting these important events like the massacre in 1641 and in 1689, the next one, the Siege of Derry. And these are events, they may seem like a long time ago for us today. Every Protestant knows everything about this. This is like it happened yesterday. This is why they fear, have this sort of siege mentality. Go ahead. The second dispersal is when these people who came to Ireland dispersed to America. That's the second dispersal. It starts in the 1680s. By 1776, about 250,000 Ulster Scots had moved. After the Revolution, another Americans after 1776, another 500,000 come. So a huge number of people who identify as being Irish in America, roughly about half of the Irish in America come from these migrations of Ulster Scots to America. Okay? They primarily come through the port in Philadelphia and settle in Appalachia, western Pennsylvania, down through West Virginia, western parts of what is now Virginia, western North Carolina, western South Carolina, east Tennessee, eastern Kentucky, northern Georgia, northern Alabama. That's where they disperse to. Okay? And often this group of people, because they migrated so early to America, they're not as well known in the U.S. I think Senator Webb published a famous book about them, trying to reinvigorate the sense of this, and East Tennessee State University has a big Scots-Irish program trying to celebrate and promote this. But in America, we mostly tend to focus on the later migrants who come after the 1820s, primarily Catholics, in the famine era and afterward, rather than this first dispersal of the Ulster Scots. The third dispersal is in the imagination today of people living in Northern Ireland and how they're reconnecting to their American ancestors, to those who left Ulster and came to America. This is called the third dispersal by people among unionists today in Northern Ireland. And the evidence that they primarily focus on are murals, and how these murals, which are common in the gables of Northern Ireland, are being repainted. The typical mural, and this is actually not a very bloody one, is ones in which, depending on which neighborhood you're in, you paint it to justify and support your side of the ethnic or sectarian conflict. And they're always extremely militaristic, often quite bloody, depicting a shooting and killing of the other side. Here it's be prepared for peace, but be ready for war, North Belfast. And there's images here which are unique to Protestant identity. The red hand of Ulster, you see a red hand and two symbols at the top. That's always a symbol of the red hand of Ulster. They're Protestant, one of the Protestant symbols. These typically are now being repainted to images like this that didn't exist before the peace process or the 1998 signing of the Belfast or Good Friday Agreement. And to understand how sectarian everything is, I use in the book just the word agreement, because if you say Belfast Agreement, that means that's how Protestants label it. If you call it the Good Friday Agreement, that's how Catholics identify it. So I try to be non-sectarian by either calling it both or only throughout the book. If you read it, it's just called the agreement, because that way it's not taking which side it is. But the Ulster Scots depict here sailing to America. You see the image of the Statue of Liberty, people from Ireland looking at the ship going off to America. Okay. Then you see another gable where you see all kinds of images of the Ulster Scots heroes in America, people like Andrew Jackson, Uncle Sam, Davy Crockett, Daniel Boone, all kinds of heroes that are based upon this sense of Ulster Scots coming to America. And this was painted by the locals, and the children who painted it are the stars there in the flag. So that's a local effort. And this would have painted over one of the old violent signs that would have, or murals that would have been on a gable there in Belfast. One of the sort of strange things is to focus on how people who were of the Scotch-Irish background in America viewed it as important to them. This is not something that usually is played up in American history, but this is a painting of President Buchanan in one of his quotes, which usually isn't in American history books, "My Ulster blood is my most priceless heritage." Okay? That's key for a Northern Irish Protestant to see, look how great our people were. We weren't just the mythological heroes. We also became the first presidents of America, and how we contributed so much to the building of American society in that revolutionary and early era of its history. And finally, after the peace process, there has been the creation of a Appalachian culture, our Ulster American folk park in Northern Ireland. I think this is in County Tyrone or County Fermanagh. And you can go, and they have like log cabins, like where the Ulster folks, when they came to America, built, and you can chop wood or whatever, just like they did back in their era, recreating the life of the people who left Northern Ireland and came to America. So it's all about reconnecting in a way, arguably, that's more positive, focusing on the achievements of their ancestors rather than we are just going to shoot Catholics. That's the changed imagery that the peace process bought, are brought or allowed, in a sense, unionists to, in some ways, focus on different elements of their identity, which we would argue is only possible because you're not presently being shot at or killed. Okay, the rest of the lessons we're going to go through focus more on the general international relations issues that are commonly studied in peace processes, not focused exclusively in Northern Ireland, but what happens in Northern Ireland that is related to other peace processes. First, you could argue that Northern Ireland teaches us that inclusiveness is important in peace processes. And there's a huge debate between, especially in the next slide, Paul Dixon writes in chapter 5 about how neoconservatives, and these are not just American neoconservatives, he's primarily talking about British neoconservatives, claim that the Northern Ireland peace process is a narrative of the IRA being defeated by the British Army, being forced to concede, and that's how peace was had. In other words, you never talk to terrorists. You defeat them, then bring them to the negotiating table and establish your victory. He argues that is the wrong depiction of what happened, because even the British government said throughout the 1990s, well, we can try to limit the damage the IRA does. We have no hope of ending all potential terrorist acts against us. And the IRA never claimed victory either. So a lot of scholars talk about, use Zartman's phrase, herding stalemate to explain what happened. Some don't like that concept of herding stalemate. Instead, they talk about an interplay. John Tung at Liverpool argues that herding stalemate doesn't allow you to understand how each side learned from each other in the process to trust each other enough to negotiate going from conflict to a less violent future, perhaps, based on negotiated settlement. So Dixon, I think, does a great job in Chapter 5 sort of dismissing these neoconservative arguments, that you ultimately you've got to get people with the guns to commit to peace. You don't do it by excluding them from negotiations. The third lesson, and this is related, is there should be as few preconditions for negotiations as possible. And this comes primarily from Jonathan Powell, the next slide, who argues that during the 1990s, after the first ceasefire, John Major required the IRA to decommission weapons after they committed to a ceasefire in order to enter negotiations. Powell argues that this was an unnecessary precondition, that just a ceasefire, if you can get those who are committing acts of violence to commit to not use their guns for a while, negotiate a settlement, then decommission their weapons. That was the more natural way of achieving the settlement. And that's what happened in Northern Ireland. There was a lot of fudging about when the IRA would have to decommission, because even the Good Friday Agreement called for decommissioning within 2 years, or actually it calls for the parties to try to get decommissioning within the next 2 years, but doesn't actually say it has to happen. Protestants sort of were told that by Tony Blair. That was part of his, what Paul Dixon calls honorable deception, in order to get Protestants to vote for the agreement. But you have to understand, from the IRA's perspective, decommissioning was unilateral surrender. Any army that has guns, to ask them to completely disarm means that they lose whatever they think they have in their arsenal to defend their interest or promote their interest. Blair makes, and his chief of staff here, Jonathan Pollack, makes a good argument that you just need the minimum preconditions to try to get negotiations started, and then hopefully convince the parties that decommissioning could happen. The fourth lesson is providing security is critical. If you look at many conflicts in Africa and other places, often there's some kind of ceasefire allowed, and then somebody breaks the ceasefire because the people still have guns. And they're afraid that if they give up their guns, they won't be secure. There were the biggest process in Northern Ireland, there was two parts of the security process that played itself out after the agreement. The first was the, next slide, the need to transform the policing. And John Doyle, who had edited, just before this book was done, he had edited the book on the transformation of Northern Irish policing, agreed to write the chapter sort of summarizing those findings. And what Doyle basically argues is that we should look at Northern Ireland as sort of an exemplar, again, to use sort of President Clinton's speech as our motto. What did Northern Ireland do right about transforming policing? And in the next slide, you'll see that what was recalled for was the creation of an independent international commission. It was led by Chris Patton, so sometimes it's known as the Patton Commission, but it had 7 people on the commission. I have 4 photographed here. They came from all over the world. Kathleen O'Toole was a Boston police commissioner. Clifford Shearing is a world-renowned South African criminal justice expert. Maurice Hayes was an Irish senator. They were from Britain, Ireland, Northern Ireland, South Africa, America. And they had legitimacy. All these people played key roles, even like Chris Patton. He was a conservative, a member of the Conservative Party, so British people, unionists liked that, but he was also publicly known to be Catholic. So Northern Irish nationalists trusted him more because of that. But more than their just identities, the process they used, they held hundreds of hearings, literally in almost every town of Northern Ireland. They went, sat, and listened at night to people's complaints and desires for the police, and they developed a very comprehensive review and then set of recommendations. The British were reluctant to do all of them, and the unionists didn't like some of them, but in the end, for the most part, they were adopted, and that allowed the police to be completely reformed. Because before this, look at the next slide, the police had been known as the Royal Ulster Constabulary. The name itself is Protestant from a Northern Irish perspective. Over 90% of the police officers were Protestants. 99% of Catholics claimed they had been harassed by the police. I mean, literally every old lady even complains, not just IRA types, but innocent old ladies were being accosted because Protestants didn't know who to trust, who not to trust when they went through Catholic neighborhoods. So they reformed the name of the police to the Police Service of Northern Ireland, a very professional, non-sectarian name. They tried to change the insignias to make it accommodating both traditions. There were other key recommendations. There were literally hundreds that were implemented, but one of the other key ones is that 50% of all new recruiting classes have to be Catholic, so there can no longer be a Protestant-dominated police force. De facto, you have to have a balanced police force of Catholics and Protestants. They created an ombudsperson, so any person who thinks they're being wrongly treated by the police can go to an independent person who had full rights to review every aspect of the police process and assess them. And the first one, Nulo Lone, was quite famous, very hard-edged, willing to take on even the chief of the PSNI for their faulty behavior. So this worked. And maybe it's not as possible in many African states that suffer from a lack of a justice ministry or police service that's objective. And we see this in many countries where it's really hard to get an effective police operation. The fifth lesson is, what is the role of third parties? Obviously, the United States plays a role in Northern Ireland like it does in many parts of the world as a powerful external actor to a local, regional, ethnic, or national conflict. It's impossible to make a general summary of the role of third parties. They can play a wide variety of roles. They can play a positive role, and that's potential. It's not always the case. Maybe more times than not, they don't work. What happened in the case of the United States and Northern Ireland is the subject of Chapter 7 by Mary Alice Clancy, who's at the University of Aberdeen in Scotland. And I think her work, and she had published previous books on this, she's considered, I think, in the world, she knows more about the role of the U.S. in Northern Ireland than anybody else, because she's looked at more documents, interviewed more people, and looked at the interaction of U.S. role with British and Irish government more than anybody else. And she comes to conclusions which probably challenge a lot of the standing assumptions of what happened in terms of the U.S. role in Northern Ireland. She looks at both the Clinton administration and its his envoy, George Mitchell's role, and tends to argue that while Clinton historically gets kudos for his role in Northern Ireland, that he fundamentally misunderstood the conflict. And her basis of this is the Taylor Branch diaries, which were published, in which, according to Taylor Branch's interviews with Clinton, he compares the Northern Ireland conflict to the white segregated South and argues that Unionists were like the whites in the South and the Catholics were like the blacks in the South in the era he grew up. And she thinks that's a fundamental misunderstanding of the dynamics of Northern Ireland. Not that there aren't some level of comparison, but he equated it too much in his own mind to that and therefore was quite sympathetic. And there is pretty good evidence that if you look at any time there was a problem in the negotiations, the Clinton administration always sided with the Catholics, okay, yeah, the Catholic side. Even though Mitchell was seen as very even-handed, Protestants respected his approach. When there was a conflict, we tended to always agree with the Catholic side. President Bush comes into office, and the typical story is Bush, you know, kind of didn't pay much attention to Northern Ireland. He tried to de-emphasize those things that Clinton was doing, and he was kind of detached. And I always tell a story on this slide of when The guy who wrote the foreword of the book, Martin Manser, was the chief Fianna Fáil advisor to the Irish Taoiseachs, or Taoiseach actually, the Irish prime ministers. And when they came to visit Bush, when the Irish Taoiseach gives the shamrock to the president every St. Patrick's Day, Bush famously told Bertie Ahern in 2001, this is before September 11th and March, obviously St. Patrick's Day, he said, give me a call, I'm not really busy if you need any questions. I'm not, you know. The Irish government were shocked that an American president acted like he didn't have much to do, that he had a lot of free time on his hands, and if you ever have any problems, just feel free to give me a call. But generally speaking, he was detached. There's not much evidence that Bush's fingerprints were on America's Northern Ireland policy. He deferred completely to his two envoys. The first envoy, Richard Haass, served simultaneously as the envoy to Northern Ireland and as the, some of you may correct me if I'm wrong, but it was a chief policy planning position within the State Department. So he was only part-time on Northern Ireland. And Haass had an interesting relationship. He didn't get along with Trimble because Trimble was too much like him. And he was fascinated with Adams, sort of this terrorist figure, romantic kind of nationalist figure as he saw him. So he ends up, even though he's kind of a, you think, a conservative guy, he would like the conservative unionist politician, in the end, he didn't get along well with Trimble, and he tended to side with Adams. And if you study, you may know that the Northern Irish government from June of last year till December of last year hired Haass to do another review and make recommendations. And in December, he came out with a report that Sinn Féin and the SDLP, the Catholic parties, immediately agreed to, but all the Protestant parties opposed. So it sure looks like Haass still has greater support and sympathy with the Catholic side in Northern Ireland. It's quite, in some ways, strange, given his politics otherwise. He left the Bush administration primarily because of his opposition to the Iraq War. It had nothing to do with Northern Irish policy. He's replaced by a classic neocon named Mitchell Rees. And Rees plays a fascinating role, and he's very eager. I mean, I was able to interact. I actually sent him drafts of certain chapters that we did, and he gave me feedback on some of the comments we made about him and the U.S. policy. And one of the interesting things was that Mary Alice makes the argument that both the British and Irish governments feared that if Sinn Féin and Adams pushed the IRA too hard in decommissioning, that some dissident Republican would shoot them and take them out, that their lives were in danger. And they love playing this up. Oh, I can't push for decommissioning because they might, you know, the crazies might shoot me. Well, there's no evidence that there was any direct, like, we don't have any phone records of people making phone calls like, I think it's time to take out Jerry or anything like that. And even though the Irish intelligence and MI5 and Britain, everybody told these politicians not to worry, they believed that they were in danger. Mitchell Rees didn't believe they were in danger. And he was the heavy. So we sort of had what I originally called in the book an unwitting good cop, bad cop policy, in which the British and Irish governments didn't want to push too hard because they didn't want anything bad to happen to Adams or McGuinness because it would all collapse if they got shot or something. Whereas Mitchell Rees said, this is crazy. And when the IRA misbehaves, like the McCartney murders, with the famous IRA Act, a bank robbery, outrageous $50 million bank robbery they did, he rescinded their visas, publicly accosted them, went off on them, et cetera, and told them either you decommission or else. You know, we're not playing games anymore. You can't tell me that you don't have influence over the IRA. Let's do it. And it allowed, in a sense, this good cop, bad cop to allow McGuinness and Adams to have to do it without being publicly humiliated by the British government, et cetera. When we said that, Mitchell Rees said, his quote was, I can assure you nothing I did without the direct knowledge of the British and Irish governments. In other words, don't try to say we didn't have a plan. So maybe he's right. Maybe there was the Irish, British, and American governments all came together and said, we're going to play this good cop, bad cop role. That's never been publicly revealed. Maybe some of the documentary evidence that comes out years from now, historians can use, can see that. But Mitchell Rees plays a very interesting role promoting the decommissioning of the IRA. And that allowed, in a sense, the DUP eventually to form a government with Sinn Féin and govern jointly now Northern Ireland. Economic aid. One of the key issues in a lot of countries that are poorer than Northern Ireland is when you get peace, there has to be a so-called peace dividend. Things have to get better. Otherwise, people don't necessarily want peace. They might be willing to go back to war. There's been a lot of economic aid poured into Northern Ireland by the British government directly, by European Union peace funds, by the American Ireland Fund. And we're not really sure how much difference they made. Now, hypothetically, if all those monies weren't spent, maybe things would be a lot worse. But it's very hard to argue that this peace-building money has triggered a huge benefit to the peace process. The chapter that's written here is written primarily by Sean Byrne, who's the director of peace studies at the University of Manitoba, and four of his PhD students. And they come to the conclusion it's really impossible to know the exact impact. But if you look at a lot of the communities where monies have been funneled in, it's clear that in local communities where there's a lot of unemployment among young males of Protestants and Catholic backgrounds, these funds give them job training, if not a job, it gives them a place to go and something to do. And then if they didn't have those, they would be the likely people who would become dissident Republicans who might think about starting violence up on the Catholic side again, or the loyalists who have been, based on the flag controversy, you followed that, turning over cars, causing lots of problems in Northern Ireland in the last year or two as well. So external aid helps relieve the economic distress of the sort of low-end economic male, young males who become the basis of paramilitary groups in Northern Ireland. Peace processes are negotiated elites, but we spent a lot of time in Chapter 9 talking about the need for grassroots reconciliation. In a sense, the peace process is broken into the negotiations among elites that lead to the agreement in 1998, and then what's happened since 98 to overcome the sectarian divide. Peace theorists use the simple term negative peace to end violent conflict between parties. Positive peace is actually overcoming and making people have a better relationship with people they historically either hated or whatever. We talk about how reconciliation hasn't happened. There was no Truth and Reconciliation Commission in Northern Ireland. And as a result, I wrote this chapter with two of my former students, Andy Oziak of Georgia, Megan Clark got her master's in conflict resolution here at American University in DC and runs a conflict resolution firm in Cincinnati. And they talk a lot about what we try to do is focus on how the lack of a reconciliation process has made securing a positive peace impossible. And we built the chapter on LETTER-X arguments about how often we think of peace, we talk about the top level leaders, but peace processes need, in the end, to really overcome the sectarian divide in Northern Ireland. You need Catholics and Protestants to get along. And the irony of the peace process is there are more walls separating Catholics and Protestants in Northern Ireland today than in 1998. So if you think you have to build walls to keep peace between people, that's not this positive sense of peace and overcoming the sectarian divide. And it creates, you can argue, the long-term potential for some future political actor to manipulate these ongoing sectarian divisions and reignite in the future a more violent level of conflict than we currently see. We relied a lot on the 2010, when we were doing this in 2011, 2010's Northern Ireland Life and Times Survey. And one of the ironies of Northern Ireland is the people have come farther in a way than the institutions lower in society have allowed. There was a question asked in 2010, how do you think better communal relations between Protestants and Catholics will be improved? You can see among everybody, it's an incredibly high percentage. Almost 90% of Catholics, almost 80-90% of Protestants agree that the way for better relations is mixing so that Catholics and Protestants actually interact. Okay? The problem in Northern Irish society is there's no mechanism to do this. The people know that's the solution, but they have segregated housing, segregated schools, segregated workforces historically, segregated butcher shops, everything is segregated. So even in towns that are 50-50, often Catholics never interact with a Protestant their entire life. The only education, for example, that's integrated is third level when you get to universities. But primary and secondary schools, 90% are either Catholic or Protestant. Only 10% of children go to school where there's people of different religious traditions. Overall, the attitudes in 2010 were quite hopeful that future relations would improve. You can see Catholics have a slightly higher view that things are going to get better in the future. But even among Protestants, very few think relations are going to get worse between Catholics and Protestants. So generally speaking, things look pretty positive. I'm going to go through a series of slides here on that. So things have gotten better. The last one was gotten better in the last 5 years. The next 5 years in 2010, Catholics here are significantly more positive in the future than Protestants. You see a much higher number of Protestants think things are going to stay the same, whereas Catholic things are going to get better. And this relates in some ways to this generational change that's going on, especially among Protestants. this graph may be a little bit hard to read, but the lighter blue color is people who identify with unionist, and we're dividing it by age group or cohort, okay? On the left are the 18 to 25 year olds, and then the beyond the far right one, the second to the right is people 65 and above. So you can sort of see an age-based decline. So among people 65 and over, more than half identify as unionist. And over half, way over half of people 65 and above are Protestants. They almost all identify as unionist. But look, there's still about a number of 18-year-olds in Northern Ireland, still over half are Protestant. But only less than 20% of people identify as being Protestant. There is a decline of willingness of Protestant young people and younger generations to identify as being unionist, more so than Catholic. There's a slight decline among Catholics, but it's not as dramatic and not as based on a clear each age cohort becomes less willing to identify. Now, what does this mean? Some worry, you know, from the Protestant tradition that, oh my God, these kids aren't going to be unionist. Some would argue unionism itself needs to be redefined. If unionism is primarily celebrated in parades, and if you've ever seen images of these parades, you know that they kind of dress up in like 1900 outfits and they wear kind of weird hats and weird little blue suits. You know, like if you're 18 and you're cool, do you really want to dress up like what your great-grandpa dressed up as the way of celebrating your traditions and identity? So in some ways, a lot of the traditions need to be recast, reformulated to appeal to the current generation, or maybe politically they just aren't as obsessed with being unionist as their older generations were. And there's some who believe this opens up a possibility for redefining people. Clearly younger people, the younger cohorts, are much more likely to say they're neither unionist or nationalist, which opens up the possibility of new political parties or movements that don't appeal to the sectarian divide. So in some ways, this is hope. But it's a very interesting question, and scholars are trying to figure out what exactly politically the ramifications are of the, in a sense, de-alignment of young Protestants, especially from their unionist identity. Lesson 8, peace processes require intense negotiations by all parties. We wouldn't have had a Northern Ireland peace without actors willing to engage. The British government, the Irish government, the US government, I mean, Clinton was highly criticized, but one third of all NSC time in his first term was spent on Northern Ireland. For 1.5 million people, it's a lot of time for the State Department, not the State Department, but the National Security Council in the White House to spend on it. The president was personally involved. Obviously, the parties in Northern Ireland were intensively involved in negotiations. It requires that in some cases, you know, you could argue the time limit that George Mitchell put on the negotiations. Tony Blair talks about the cramped conditions in Belfast for the final week of the negotiations. Like you hated being in those rooms so much, you just wanted to finish it and agree to it so you get out. It was like a, you know, prison to him, the way he describes it. So all those meant that there was a huge incentive for the peace process to move forward. Lesson 9, peace process should support moderates who take risk for peace and not become outflanked by so-called spoilers. There's a lot in the IR literature about how even if a lot of the good people all want to make peace, if there's people throwing bombs on the outside, they break down the peace process. So so-called spoilers, extremists, sometimes they're called dissidents. You have to make them part of the peace process, and that's what worked in Northern Ireland. You supported the moderates, and the next image is sort of the great image of supporting this. This was during a public concert that U2, led by the ever-present Bono, is holding up the hands of Trimble and Hume, who represented at the time the two largest parties, the Catholics and Protestants. You know, he's obviously screaming in support, telling people in Northern Ireland to vote in favor of the referendum that the concert was trying to support after it was negotiated. So you need to support, these are the good guys. They're willing to make concessions, bring peace, they win Nobel Prizes for their efforts. Those are all good things. And we could go on with for Bob Bono if you want afterward, but this doesn't make him popular in Ireland, by the way. It may make him popular here, but like as the Irish say, whoever voted for Bono. Anyway, go ahead. Probably more important than supporting the moderates in some ways is making the extremists moderates and thereby marginalizing any potential spoilers. And the ultimate agreement that brought some kind of stability to the Northern Ireland governing system was when these two men at the bottom, in the famous photo that's called Chuckles Brothers, finally agree to share power. Ian Paisley, who throughout his career was often called Dr. No, because whatever was offered, he said no, right? I mean, he said that no from the, he was the famous guy who sabotaged the 1974 Sunningdale Agreement with the Ulster worker strike, where he got well over 500,000 of the Protestants to march and refuse to work and basically shut down Northern Ireland to stop the Sunningdale Agreement and that effort at peace. He refused to negotiate the Good Friday Agreement once, and even be involved in negotiations once Sinn Féin was in there. He called everybody horrific names, including even the British, the Irish, especially the Irish, Catholics especially. His anti-Catholic rhetoric was legendary, world-class, if you like anti-Catholic rhetoric. But in the end, you see him laughing and sharing power with Martin McGuinness, who is a self-admitted commander of the IRA from Derry, probably involved with lots of IRA activities, including hits. But in the end, they're willing to share power in 2007. It was, in some ways, you know, very late in Paisley's career. I think he's 80-ish when he finally agrees to peace. I mean, it's amazing he did so. But he also did so because the British and Irish governments put him in a corner and basically said, either you share power now, or we're going to have Bertie Ahern come up from Dublin and start deciding things about Northern Ireland. And if you're a unionist, what's worse than having to share power with Martin McGuinness is letting somebody from Dublin come up and tell you what happens in your country. So they pushed him, in a sense, to agree to this process. In the end, they worked famously together. These photos are not aberrations. It's shocking these people of such diverse, antagonistic political backgrounds could effectively share power as First Minister and Deputy First Minister so well in the Stormont government. So it does leave a potential problem in that while Adams and McGuinness like to say all the Republicans came with them, we know that some people think they sold out. Who represents you if you're a Republican and thinks this is a sellout? There's not a United Ireland. There's nobody. Maybe it's time to go out and get some fertilizer and blow some crap up again, right? Those are the dissident Republicans. Similarly, if you're a DUP and you think this whole thing is a sham, having to share power with these guys, come on, I'm a unionist. I don't have to share power with Catholics, or I'm a loyalist. These guys sold out too. Who represents them? So there's a problem at the extremes today, you can argue, where there's no political representation for people who are outside of these two parties, Sinn Féin and the DUP. And that political vacuum, if manipulated right by a demagogue, is still a potential problem if you look to the future of Northern Ireland. You have to keep watching out for spoilers. The last part of the talk here, we'll end up here, is the tenth lesson, is that changes in world politics, and to some extent domestic circumstances as well, can make peace processes more likely. And in the last chapter, Robert Snyder, chapter 10, talks about the renunciation of revolutionary nationalism. By the 1990s, Sinn Féin and to some extent the IRA had seen themselves as sort of revolutionary Marxist organizations. When the Soviet Union goes belly up, you can look at the next slide, you know, with the end of the Cold War, how cool is it to be a commie anymore? Like, I mean, you know, they had copied, for example, a green book of Gaddafi and created the IRA's green book, you know. Is Gaddafi cool by the 1990s? By the 1990s, the Celtic Tiger takes off in the South. Capitalism looks pretty good if it's in the form of the Celtic Tiger allowing huge amount of wealth, increased income, living standards, you know, demanding socialist poverty is not going to get you many votes. So we required a rethinking, in a sense. The holding on of a romantic revolutionary form of nationalism had to end. And pragmatic, more civic forms of nationalism, you could argue, emerge at the end of the Cold War. The other big dramatic event, which comes after the 1998 agreement, which you could argue had a significant event, was September 11th. Not that Al-Qaeda and the attacks had any direct relationship, but indirectly, Americans' attitude towards terrorists changed, right? Especially the American government became much less tolerant. It was harder to romanticize Adams as some sort of revolutionary figure when he was nothing more than a terrorist, hiding bombs, blowing up innocent people in Belfast, London. We're not going to tolerate that anymore. And Haas, before he left, famously met on 9/11 with McGuinness and Adams, because a month before, the IRA had gotten caught training FARC rebels in Colombia, and the Bush administration was outraged by that. So that was what the meeting was for, but it turns out the meeting happened right after, literally within hours of the 9/11 attack. And Haas was even more irate after that and said, it is time for you to stop this. And ironically, within a month, we had the first decommissioning of IRA weapons. So that probably had something to do with it. It's hard to argue not, based on the time sequence. And I think that's the last slide. So the photo here comes from, I wrote this book in the fall, or edited it in the fall of 2011. This photo was taken in May of 2011, and I wanted this photo. I think it's the first time it's used in a Northern Ireland book at all, for a lot of reasons. It's very significant in that McGuinness is shaking the hand of the Queen. It probably is the case that McGuinness ordered the hit that killed Lord Mountbatten, her cousin, or whoever Lord Mountbatten, the member of the royal family in Gibraltar back in the late 70s, early 80s, when he was killed. We think McGuinness ordered that hit. So for her to sort of smile at a guy who ordered the killing of her relative, you know, something hard. For him to shake the hand of the state that has occupied his country from his perspective for 850 years or whatever it is something that's hard to tolerate as well. And I also like, you probably didn't even know, the man in the middle is Peter Robinson. He's the first minister of Northern Ireland. He replaced Paisley when Paisley retired, left the party. He's kind of mildly smiling at Martin, like, look, you can shake her hand, you know. And even she wearing, not Kelly green, but kind of a nice shade of green, sign of saying, I'm trying to be Irish too. This photo is a little different than it's on the cover in that the person who did this for me knew Photoshop. We Photoshopped out Prince Philip because we don't think he's important. But in the book, they had to use the official photo, I think. So Prince Philip's kind of behind the Queen's hat. So anyway, that's why that photo was chosen. Any questions you have on the talk or elements of what I argue? Yes. Okay.
And I would like to hear your perspective on the referendum that is going to go this year in Scotland about it.
Well, I'm not an expert at all on Scotland, but from what I see in the opinion polls, it seems to be that a slight majority of people still look like they favor staying within the UK, the last I saw at least. But it's close enough that a good political campaign by the opposition could maybe get Scotland's independence. If Scotland would vote, I'm just saying this hypothetically, I'm not predicting it, but if that would happen, if the Scottish would vote, it would have a big impact on Northern Ireland because it would force unionists to realize that their fate isn't necessarily linked with the UK as much as it now is. They see themselves much like other parts of what's often called the Celtic periphery, Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland. Even though these people came from Scotland themselves and aren't really part of the earlier Celtic civilization of people going back thousands of years, they still identify with that sort of sense of being part of a United Kingdom, which includes Scot, Wales, and Northern Ireland. But I mean, even then, we wouldn't know exactly. I mean, it wouldn't have an immediate impact. The majority in support of staying within the UK is significant. Even a probably 10 to 20% of Catholics would vote today to stay part of the UK. So what has to happen for any transformation of Northern Ireland under the terms of the Good Friday Agreement, we have to get a vote in a national referendum, both in the South, which would be easy, I think, but in the North to agree to it. And all opinion polls in Northern Ireland show we're still at 60 to 65% in favor of staying in the UK. There are practical things to consider about this going beyond the nationalist argument. The British highly subsidize Northern Ireland. Given the Republic of Ireland's financial problems now, if you're sitting in Northern Ireland, you may think that that government in Dublin probably can't give you the same subsidies that the British do now. And McGuinness and Robinson have been unbelievably effective in convincing Cameron to keep up the subsidies. Because one of Cameron's goals is to shrink the British government's spending. These guys say, oh, if you touch our budgets, well, the bombers will come out, you'll have to bring more soldiers over, etc. So they've been very effective at jointly pressing because it helps both communities. The money goes to Catholics and Protestant schools, hospitals, all the subsidized because Northern Ireland is heavily subsidized. It's also small. It's about 1.5 million people. The UK is, what, about 70 million now? So, I mean, it's so small that in some ways they can subsidize that small a number of people and not, it's not too costly for the overall British exchequer. But I think it does open up an unknown possibility if Scotland would vote to secede and form their own country. I don't know enough of Scottish opinion to accept that the polls I see show that a slight majority still seem to favor being in the UK. Yeah, Mark?
I just wonder if you could say a little bit more about the educational system and whether you see any examples of changes in programs or school systems trying to help kids who are growing up in an environment where they've grown up in a more peaceful Northern Ireland have ways of bridging those Catholic Protestant divides. So that builds that generational change a little bit more systematically.
The schools are difficult because the Catholic hierarchy totally opposes integrated education. In the Catholic and Protestant, the Church of Ireland and the Roman Catholic Church in Ireland are based in Armagh, which is where St. Patrick's buried, or that's the seat of the church. And the primate continues to argue and continue the benefits of Catholics having Catholic education. So he refuses to consider the possibility of integrated education. And that tends to reinforce, if Catholics are still going to go to Catholic schools, then you're not going to get mixed schools because Protestants don't have anybody to mix with, in a sense. So I think there's a little less, my only point there is I think Protestants are somewhat less resistant to integrated education than actually Catholics are. And it's primarily the Catholic hierarchy. Over half of Catholics support integrated education for their children. It's just the hierarchy doesn't support it. Beyond that...
Is that because it's a threat to them?
It's just a tradition that Catholics... There's also a great suspicion among the hierarchy that the British government would somehow teach Protestant values to Catholic children if they went to Protestant schools or the schools controlled by the state. The hierarchy, despite a lot of sex scandal and other problems, the politicians don't want to take them on at this point. At some point, the politicians may. In the South, in the Republic, the politicians have taken the church on and faced down the church, and now the church runs. If the government comes after them, they run because they know the public is on the side of the government. And that's primarily because the sex scandals have actually affected the government more. Official hiding of, even after new processes are in place, bishops have been hiding sex abuse of priests even in the last decade or so. So that has been seen as intolerable by the government because the church has basically signed up. If there's any evidence of a crime, we have to release that information to the authorities to be investigated. And there's especially one bishop in the Wexford diocese called Ferns was clearly not doing what was officially the church had agreed to do. In the North, the sex scandal hasn't diffuse the church. Catholicism is much more practiced. Church attendance is much higher in the North among Catholics than it is in the South. There's just a much stronger institutional church presence still, and that makes it harder to change. The only avenue you see a little change is in sports. Historically, Catholics played Irish football, and in Antrim they play a little hurling. They play Gaelic games. Protestants play soccer and rugby, so they don't even play the same sports. There is a group called Peace Players International that tries to introduce basketball to Northern Ireland because basketball is an American sport. It can't be seen as Catholic or Protestant. And that's worked a little, but there's not still a lot of basketball in Northern Ireland. More positive is in the last year or two, there have been summer camps created for Protestants and Catholic kids to learn all the sports, and they play all of them. So they'll play an hour of rugby, an hour of soccer, an hour of hurling, an hour of football. And some Protestant kids are starting to like GA games because if you're really good hand-eye coordination, maybe hurling's best for you. You know, whereas if you're a big guy, maybe rugby's best for you, right? I mean, so, you know, based on your physical characteristics, you might end up choosing different games to play as a kid or as a young adult. That holds some hope, although, you know, it's still, if you go to a GA match in the North, you're not going to find a lot of Protestants there. Yeah, and you're not going to find a lot of Catholics at a rugby match. Ben?
Yeah, could you talk about, you talked a little bit about it already, but what is the effect of the economic collapse of the 2009-2010 on kind of long-term peace prospects and affecting overall politics in the country?
Well, their unemployment was relatively high anyway, and they benefited from a peace dividend in that they were attracting companies. The Northern Irish government, and McGuinness is interesting, you know, he's an old-fashioned supposed socialist, but he's become a huge advocate of the high-tech companies that came to the south of Ireland now coming to the north. So he's trying to get Google and all these kinds of high-tech companies to come to the north because the northern kids are roughly educated just as well as the south. There's no huge educational achievement gap between the north and the south, and the technological capabilities are big. The difficulty they face is that because Northern Ireland is part of the UK, corporate taxes are 35% in the United Kingdom, including Northern Ireland, it's 12.5%. in the Republic of Ireland. So if you're using a workforce that's equally well trained, but you're going to get taxed three times as much as a corporation, why go north? You know, so it's a harder sell to get foreign multinationals to invest there. But their funding from the EU is a EU funding, which is primarily the Germans, you know, and the Germans are still okay. So my sense is there is a sense that they can't keep funding them as high as they did in the immediate aftermath. But I know people who work in the peace business who are like community organizers, community relations workers. There's new EU rounds of funding coming into effect and trying to help these marginalized young males, especially, who don't have jobs, who are not well educated, they didn't go to college, they're not, you know, it's like a lot of other parts of the industrialized world. There's not a huge job, they can't learn a trade, there's no job prospects for them, and they hang out, and then they get angry when if you're a loyalist, you know, they take your flag off of your city hall in Belfast, and you got nothing better to do than just to turn over cars for a week. So you just go and turn over every car you can find and burn it, you know, and how to convince those people not to do it. And that's seen as outrageous by most members. One of the real interesting things going on in Northern Ireland is that the prosperous middle unionist class is totally alienated from these loyalists. There is an increasing economic division. There really isn't anybody that represents this loyalist working class, though, because all these people have become more bourgeois. You know, they're more middle class oriented in terms of their politics, you know. Especially among Protestants, yeah.
The fact that Tony Blair became a Catholic in 2007 changed in any way reviewing his decisions during the peace process? Do you see any
difference? He and his government were clearly less hostile to Catholics than anybody else. He was more comfortable. I mean, the fact that he was married to a Catholic even before he became Catholic made him, I don't know, maybe less suspicious of Catholics. So when he dealt with Bertie Ahern or any Irish government official who came from a Catholic background, he was less other. I mean, religion, even in the south of Ireland, is still, it may be not as obvious as in the north, but it's still a basic division. And that tension, and I'm less familiar with British attitudes towards Catholics. I mean, I do know that numerically now there are more Catholics in Britain than any other single religion. There's more Catholics than there are Church of England followers. So I think the British society has become more multicultural, diverse, and accepted that there's all kinds of diversity, Muslims, Hindus, Catholics, all kinds of people. So that there's less maybe of a division than there used to be. But, you know, everybody in the Republic would have known Blair was a Protestant when the negotiations. I mean, they all know that. In the Republic, it said, and I don't think this is used in North, but if you're a Protestant and you're in the Republic, they say you kick with your left foot. That's how it's expressed. So if you meet somebody and they say, you know, he kicks with his left foot, they'll never call somebody a Protestant. It's like cues. They use indirect cues for who they are. So there is a sense of, you know, understanding the dynamic, you know, because for centuries Catholics would see themselves as being colonized, you know, they all know they couldn't own land, they couldn't vote. Their rights were taken away for centuries by Protestants. They're not going to forget that, you know, for a while. The Irish people are obsessed with history more than most other groups. You know, some people argued for the peace process to work, you got to start thinking about the future more than thinking about the past. And they're obsessed with history. Protestants know more about 1689 than they know about 1989, because 1689 was important. They got screwed, you know, they got attacked, you know, that's important. Yeah.
You talked a little bit earlier about the people who started on the grassroots level being more open to mixing and that sort of change identity, but that the institutions didn't reflect that, so that there are more walls today than there were. What do you think is necessary to perhaps bridge that gap between the people and the institutions?
Community leaders, people at the grassroots, you know, parish priests, local ministers, people who are heads of local neighborhood associations, working across whoever is the next community over, developing potluck dinners. I mean, it's got to be very localized. It's what, you know, Putnam calls in American context sort of civil society. There is no civil society between Catholics and Protestants. The social capital that exists in Ireland is called bonding capital. It bonds each group to each other rather than bridging social capital, overcoming the divide between the two groups. So you need institutional arrangements that provide it. And like I said, if sports doesn't do it, most workplaces historically were segregated. You know, if you were a Protestant business, you didn't hire Catholics. People would say, well, I know my Protestant neighbor who needs a job. Why are you going to hire a Catholic? You know, so I think, you know, famous, you know, Bushmills whiskey, I don't think it's still ever allowed a Catholic to work there for almost 500 years or whatever it is now. Balique pottery, there's no Catholics working at Balique. You know, I mean, there's long traditions of employers that are, you know, even like the shipyards in the days when Belfast was a huge shipbuilding industry, it was all Protestants that built the ships. There were no Catholics allowed because there was enough shortage of Protestant labor that you helped them out. So there was always the unemployment rates in Northern Ireland were always twice as high for Catholics as Protestants. And I think today it's still roughly 10% for Protestants, 20% for Catholics. So it's a historic problem.
There's been conversation in South Africa with passing of Mandela that there's a possibility of a political diversification that hasn't happened before, or that people have felt very much tied to the ANC. When you show the graph of people's identification, do you think that there's a space or a moment coming where there could be greater political diversification in Northern Ireland, that it wouldn't just be whether or not you're Republican or Unionist, but that there are other interests that need to be represented, and that there's a space that could be opening up for that kind of diversification?
It's possible. The only reason why I say we don't necessarily see it yet is that they use a kind of elections called single transferable votes. So when voters vote, they can rank order their voters, their candidates, from one to however many are on the list. So you could vote number one for a Protestant, number two for a Protestant, but then vote seven or eight for a Catholic, hypothetically. On all ballot papers, less than 2% of people ever put somebody outside of one tradition on their list. So you vote for all Protestants or you vote for all Catholics. So if you're a politician and you see that, and all politicians know this, you say, I want to be this new figure and try to transcend the divide. And everybody says, well, I vote for the guy who's going to be, or the woman who's going to be most pushing Protestant issues or most benefiting Catholics. I want a Catholic hospital for this town, or I want a Protestant school for this neighborhood. You're going to get lost. There is a tiny little party in Northern Ireland called the Alliance. Now, it's technically under the terms of the Good Friday Agreement, you have to say if you're a Protestant or Catholic party when you go into Stormont. You have to publicly state that. They had to state that they are a Protestant party. And they're basically the party of liberal Presbyterians. These are mostly, they're led by the leader of the Presbyterian Church, I think Lord Alderdice is kind of a elder or whatever in the Presbyterian Church. He's clearly a very nice, I've seen him speak, he's a very nice man. There's no anti-Catholic rhetoric, bone in his body. But just he oozes something that's not going to appeal to Catholic voters, right? I mean, just who he is, his background, his identity just is not something that's ever going to, he's not in any way, he would want fair housing, fair schools, no, not having all the benefits to his community at all. He would think that would be wrong. And even though he sincerely does that, believes in it, he's not going to get any Catholic votes. I think in a hypothetical sense, it looks like there's an opening, but we don't see voters transferring enough to really give an encouragement to a politician to say, look, I'm going to form this new party, and it's the Alliance Plus or something, or whatever you want to call it, that goes beyond the sectarian divide. Maybe in 20 or 30 years, when that young generation is more mature, something will happen. But a lot of people think there should be a class-based system, right? We need a class party that advocates for workers, whether they're working class Protestants or Catholics, but nobody's tried that yet. So.
All right, well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.